Welcome back. This is part two of this production regarding what happened at the UN today. Vote of no confidence for the US's Mr. Trump's decision to move Washington's embassy from Tel Aviv to Al-Quds, or as they call it, Jerusalem. 128 countries said no. We'll have to see what happens next. We would be very interested in some of these countries just sever their diplomatic relations with Israel. Maybe something good could come out of this. I remember last year at this exact time, I was officially invited to Iran for the sixth Palestine conference that the Iranian parliament was organizing. They had 800 guests from 70 countries. Me and I was part of the American delegation, the unofficial American delegation, and all the movers and shakers were there. And we all rubbed the elbows and we talked and we got energized and we got into committees afterwards. When the politicians were done with their speeches and what have you, we got into committees, many committees. Academics like myself participated. We came up with innovative ideas, solutions. We networked. It was excellent. This is something that happened, a year ago. And then we had the OIC meeting not too long ago that declared unanimously, almost, that the East Jerusalem, East Al-Quds, is going to be the capital of the future Palestinian state. So there's some tremendous gains. And I was just on air telling Press TV that it's interesting how things end up working. The geopolitical consequences, unintended consequences, as a result of Mr. Trump's completely ill-advised the decision to move the capital, to move the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. This has rallied the Palestinian cause once again. Every time you think the Palestinian cause is being, what did the Bahraini guy say? What did he say? Let's go back to his ridiculous comment. He said, blah, 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 blah. I want to just verbatim what he said. Oh, yeah. He said that fighting with the U.S. over Palestine has not been helpful. Of course it won't be helpful because you're their stooges. Yeah, it's not going to help you. And that Iran was a real threat. So they're resorting. Some of these countries are resorting to Shia phobia, Iranophobia. They have drunk the Kool-Aid of Mr. Netanyahu. They're being fooled. They're not exactly intelligent. And they're casting the lots with the devils, the two devils in this region. Themselves, the Israelis and the Saudis. It's incredible to me. It's incredible to me. But I did mention on air that, when you sell this vassal state, Saudi Arabia, this puppet regime over there, when you sell these people, when Mr. Trump went there earlier this year and sold them $350 billion of weaponry, what do you think they're going to do for it? In order to convince their own indigenous populations that they spend all this money on a bunch of weapons, they're going to have to create a paper tiger. They're going to have to create an enemy. This, of course, is the exact strategy of Washington for as long as we know, especially during the past 70 years, what President Eisenhower called the military-industrial complex, in order to justify their horrendous the defense budgets, Pentagon budgets. They're going to have to come up with enemies. And they completely, it's total falsehood. It has nothing to do with what's going on in reality. Has Washington's behavior in the region alienated many countries? Yes. Have some countries been alienated for a long time? Yes. Does Washington have clear enemies in the region? Yes, it does. Could Washington's behavior perhaps persuade some of these countries to perhaps want to have some kind of a limited diplomatic relations with it? Yes. Yes, it could, but they didn't. The JCPOA, the Iranian nuclear agreement, was a perfect example of that. They reneged because they want to have enemies. They want to have enemies. And of course, it's two-sided. There are people in some of these countries in the Middle East that, they're going to... have some kind of a normalized, limited relationship with Washington until hell freezes over. So it takes two to tango. At this point, though, it's getting dangerous. The Saudis and their GCC vassal states, along with Israel and Washington, have lost in Syria. And so they are, it's like a wounded beast that wants to bite the next thing that comes on his path. And they're trying to use coercive power. There are three forms of power. You have coercive power, you have legal power that could be used coercively, which would be illegal, and then you have the power of ideas or ideological power. Washington no longer has any ideological power in the region because it has lost its role as the honest broker. It has no solutions. Its solutions are all so one-sided, so pro-Israelis, that no one is going to jump on that bandwagon except for a couple of traitor countries, like Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, unofficially. And its legal power is no longer respected because it used it coercively in 2001 and then continuing to 2003. By the way, 2001 war against Afghanistan is the longest war in the history of the United States. And then the attack in 2013 illegally under false pretext, something that they want to do again against Iran. And what else did I want to say? They wanted to export this madness, this chaos, and then they call it the Arab Spring. This was a project of the neoliberals in Washington, warmongers like President Obama, warmongers and war criminals like Hillary Clinton. And these policies have clearly failed, not to mention the blood and toil of the American soldiers, not to mention hundreds of, we can't say hundreds, but tens of millions of people who have migrated, hundreds of thousands who have been killed, and $6 trillion was a number that was being quoted by Mr. Trump during the debates against Hillary Clinton. So it has gone nowhere. And at a time like this, usually you would want a president that would acknowledge some defeat, perhaps. They would never do that, but acknowledge that the fact that they need to kind of get out a little bit. And Mr. Trump was talking like that. He really was saying the right things in some of these debates when he pointed his finger at Hillary Clinton. But what we saw not too long after he got elected was launched those Tomahawk cruise missiles at Syria. Over 50 of them. Our intelligence sources told us that only 28 of them hit their target. Nevertheless, he completely broke his word. He wanted to be reconciliatory with Russia in Syria. And my Russian colleagues who I communicate on a daily basis tell me that basically the Russians never, after that, they were done with Trump. They were really done with guy. They had some hope that they could negotiate, that the Trump would be different, that President Obama, who basically wanted to create World War III before he went, all these bogus the charges against the so-called Russian intervention or election. They were trying to use the deceptive linguistic inventiveness and injecting it into people's minds in the United States during the past year, to the point where people are believing it. Some of the so-called intelligent people are believing in this. At any rate, I'm on the left, So that's what they wanted to do. They wanted to start World War III, and then Trump's mandate was to approach it differently. Of course, the media completely manipulated that. Mr. Trump could be having a conversation with Mr. Putin by the bathroom, and they would turn that into some kind of espionage situation. It's absolutely ridiculous, the amount of ignorance and propaganda that's being spewed out of CNN primarily, or as I like to call them, FNN, not CNN, FNN, fake news network. At any rate, I did write an article about this. I'm not going to go over that here, but it was pitiful. 9 countries stood with Israel. Of course, one of them was Israel, as usual, Washington, and then all these tiny little countries. I got to mention to you, it was a joke. It was pathetic. I mean, the Israelis should feel pathetic. I really enjoyed how this warmonger Netanyahu, he was so angry, calling, actually using derogatory language, using maybe not necessarily derogatory, but undiplomatic language, attacking the whole entire organization of United Nations. The countries that allied themselves in supporting Israel's war crimes, but by agreeing with this transfer of U.S. embassy from Tel Aviv to Al-Quds, or as they call it, Jerusalem. Obviously, Israel, duh. United States, Guatemala, okay, Washington colony, Honduras, the Washington colony, Marshall Islands, Washington colony, Micronesia, Washington colony, Togo, Honduras, Guatemala. These are all, these are all vassal states for Washington. Okay, so it was pitiful. It's pitiful for Israel that nobody. Well, actually, it's wonderful that nobody's standing with them. But they should feel really pitiful, really pitiful. They're really nothing. If the U.S. if somehow we manage to awaken the masses and have it, which would not happen because the Israelis have tremendously powerful lobbies in Washington. But if you actually manage to have, imagine for a second, if you have the right senators and congressmen, or if the number of Israeli bought and paid for politicians in U.S. Congress decreases, and you would actually have, we have to give President Obama some credit. He stood up to some extent for Palestinian rights like nobody else had. At least George Bush hadn't. Maybe President Clinton to some extent, but he did stand up to Netanyahu. He didn't have the two of them didn't have a cordial relationship at all. As a matter of fact, they really disliked each other. The 35 countries that abstained, those cowardly countries, shameless servants of Washington that abstained from voting, tragically, but not to be shocked. Canada is run by the Zionists. I have to tell you this. Argentina, Colombia, Mexico, and this is for another 31 countries. We don't have time to name these countries. But I want to quote Dante Alighieri, the famous Italian medieval poet and author. Dante said something very interesting, and that was, in times of great, the hottest places in hell, I've said this quite often on in front of camera, the hottest places in hell are reserved for those who, during times of great moral crisis, maintain their neutrality. We cannot be neutral on the Palestinian Israeli issue. Go back a few years back. Could any country be neutral against apartheid South Africa? Well, I tell you, the only country that was standing behind them was Israel. They had multi-billion dollar defense contracts between the two of these. What would that tell you? When we say Israel is an apartheid state, it literally is, because it was completely behind the apartheid state of South Africa. But you saw what happened. That regime was wiped off the earth. The majority of the people took over. The black South Africans and the whites are still there. There are issues. They had someone like Mandela. It worked for a while. There was reconciliation. Now some of these issues have potential of unrest. But the point is that nobody was standing behind them. Nobody was. Everybody was disgusted by the South African, white population's racism and bigotry and apartheid status. So the same thing eventually will happen to the Zionist entity, to Israel. We're going to cut the production here. So in the third part, hopefully, we're going to wrap it up. Thank you for your support. Please stand by for part 3.